Okay, so today we're going to explore Archimedes' principle by trying to answer the question: if you have floating ice cubes in a glass of water, will the level of water change when the ice melts? So will the level of water go up or down once the ice has completely melted? So we're going to use four different types of ice, or ice that has slightly different characteristics in four different ways. And each one of these identical glasses has been marked where 250 milliliters of water will reach. So we can demonstrate that right here. We have some previously measured out water, 250 milliliters. You can see it reaches that level on the glass. And we'll put it back in there. That'll be 250 milliliters. So what we've done is previously measured the weight of each of the ice cubes, or total of ice cubes that will go in each glass, and we are going to add water back into the glass until it reaches that level, and we're going to measure the remaining water in the Pyrex cup so that way we can determine how much water has been added. And we'll use all of this data for our calculations, and we'll try to figure out if Archimedes was correct, and we'll try to answer our question of whether or not this level of water changes. So we'll get the ice from the freezer. All right, so we have our ice from the freezer, and each one of these glasses was in the freezer previously, so they're a little bit cooler than room temperature, and hopefully the ice doesn't immediately melt. But we'll put our standard freezer ice that's been created by the freezer itself first, and we'll put that into this glass and pour off some water until it reaches that level. And looks like we just need a touch more. All right. So that is our level there. And what we're going to do is we're going to put these back in the freezer so they don't melt. But we'll repeat for each one of these, and we're going to record this level of water and try to figure out how much we've used. Okay, so a few details. We've wrapped our first cup with Saran wrap to help prevent any sort of evaporation during the melting process. And although the accuracy on this is only so great, we were using this to pour the water off in and get a little bit more accuracy down to the 5 milliliter or maybe 2 milliliter plus or minus range, maybe plus or minus one. And then we have our three other ice cubes. So we'll go through exactly what we have here. This is a spherical ice cube which has iron nails embedded into it. And previously we weighed those iron nails before they're made into the ice cube. And these spherical cubes were created using these silicone ramekins. This is a plain water ice sphere. And this one, although it's larger because of the way it was created, has an air pocket on the inside. So this was created using this setting into one of those ramekins as the ice froze, and this one has an air pocket in. So this has nails, this has air, and this is solid ice. So with each one of those, we're going to start with 250 milliliters, adding water until we get to this level. Same process as with the first glass, we'll determine how much water it takes for it to reach that level. Okay, so we've moved across the kitchen to do some calculations. We have some data to work with, and we're going to go ahead and approach Archimedes' principle from the perspective of melting ice in a glass. So the first thing we want to talk about is density. So we know if we put a few items into water, that air is going to float. It's going to be above the water. Ice, we all know ice floats, and we all know that nails are going to sink to the bottom of the water. So knowing that those are the ingredients we're working with, we can say, with regards to density, the density of the nails is greater than the density of water, which is greater than the density of the ice, and that's greater than the density of the air. So, knowing these things, approaching this, what we can say is that, according to Archimedes' principle, if we have an ice cube, it's going to be displacing a certain amount of water, and the force supporting our ice cube is going to be equal to the mass of the water that's been displaced. So let's draw an ice cube. All right. So we have a certain amount of our ice cube below the water, and what we know is that the mass of that displaced volume is equal to the force that's supporting this ice cube. But what we also know is that this ice cube is composed of water itself. So when this ice cube melts, the mass is going to be equal to this. It's going to be the same amount of mass because by definition it's made of the same material. So what we can say is that whatever the density is of ice compared to the density of water, that's going to be equivalent to the amount of ice that's below, the volume below, compared to the volume of the entire ice cube. So, if we can find out that this is about 0.92, right? Then we know that about 8% is above. But what's more important is that when this melts, the mass of this ice cube is by definition equal to the mass of the water. It will therefore also have the same volume when it's melted as the volume that's been displaced. So the water will stay at the same level. So let's go ahead and make a table over here. Because we're dealing with four types of ice cubes. And we know that if it's our standard freezer ice, and if it's the standard spherical ice, they're both made of ice water. Water ice, that is. And so we will have a water level that stays the same. So we want to consider that we have two other ice cubes, a sphere with nails and a sphere with air. So let's actually start by considering the sphere with air. Let's draw a different diagram, and we'll say it's like that. And inside is air. Now, what we don't want to consider is the idea that when this melts, the air is somehow going to end up below the surface. The only thing that will stay below the surface of the water is the melted water ice. So, this really isn't even part of our system. But more importantly, it's the same density as the outside air. So there's neutral buoyancy between the air inside the ice cube and outside the ice cube. If we were to fill this with a more dense gas, or put it in an environment with a less dense outside, perhaps helium, then yes, there would be some buoyant force provided, and this would end up displacing water, potentially, if it was more dense than water at the end. But it's not going to be the case. The air is going to leave our system. You could provide extra force by pushing the ice down. then the volume might change and the water level would drop. But that's not the case that we have provided. So in fact, indeed, the water level will stay the same. So finally, considering our spherical ice with nails embedded, what we want to think about is the volume at the end of the melting process. So for these considerations, this will only consider the sphere with nails. The volume of the melted ice component, that's just ice, not the nails, is equal to the volume of the water that's supporting that ice. Okay, so same situation here, that's equal. But that's not all we're dealing with. We also have the volume of the nails. So the volume of the nails is here. And we want to compare that to the volume of the water supporting the nails. And we know that the density of the nails is greater than the density of the water. So that means if the mass is equal, because that's what Archimedes tells us, then we can actually say that the volume is less for the nails than the supporting water. So when our ice cube melts, the volume that has been displaced is greater than the volume of the total melt. All right. What does that tell us? That tells us the water level goes down in the case with the embedded iron nails. So, the final thing we want to consider. How did we do? Did we do a good job? So, according to Archimedes, the mass should be equal to the supporting force, and we know that the mass of water is going to be about 1 gram per cubic centimeter. And 1 centimeter cubed is the same as 1 milliliter. That's how we measured our displaced volume. So, if we compare our data, hopefully we can pull focus, then what we know is that we got an error of 2.08, 3.08, 4.33, 12.4, respectively, for the standard freezer ice, the spherical ice, with the nails, and with the air. Now, what I would have to comment is that the air, more than likely, that was the most complicated ice cube to try to construct to make sure that it did indeed have an air pocket. It was the most irregular. That's possibly due to that. But otherwise, we're actually within the fairly large expected error range because the water measurement process wasn't entirely precise. But either way, let's go compare our results and see, did our water levels indeed stay the same? And did the water levels of the nail go down? Pieces of equipment that were used in this process. Digital scale to weigh the ice, which was wrapped in saran wrap to prevent it from getting shorted out. The water levels were measured slightly more precisely than the Pyrex cup using that. And then we have our results. So if we pan over, the spherical shaped ice does more or less appear to be the same. We come over here. Ice cube with the air in it, right there, about the same. Here's ours with the nails. Let's see if we can pick that up. Let's have this saran wrap so it wouldn't evaporate. That's not too much of a consideration in a short period of time. Let's settle, let that settle down
check out our final one. The one with the standard freezer ice seems to be right about the same. Alright, so going back to the one with the nails, that's the only one we expect to be much different. Let's see if, how it looks. Look at that. There seems to indeed be a difference. Alright. Perhaps Archimedes would be proud.
Alright. So here we are with one final shot of some of our work on the board. Let's get a quick look at some of our data. Alright. Everyone have a wonderful day. Keep doing physics.